is Angela Solis. I'm a lead organizer here at Make the Road New York. I have grown up in communities in Eastern Washington that are very dependent on massive corporations like Hanford, for example, or the nuclear energy waste plant out by where I grew up, or massive agricultural corporations. So I've always grown up seeing just how much power massive companies have in dictating the life of an entire community, the health outcomes, the employment status, social mobility and agency, political prowess. So I came to Make the Road New York to join an organization that mobilizes and organizes impacted communities like immigrant workers against the world's corporate powers that are most harming, particularly Black, Indigenous, and Brown communities all over the world, but even here in New York City. So I came to Make the Road New York, and my first week on the job, the announcement about Amazon HQ2 dropped in Queens. So I would say one of the biggest reasons our membership of over 24,000 members at Make the Road and with a massive coalition in the city decided to organize against Amazon HQ2 was primarily the immediate displacement, right? We knew that the gentrification and the impending criminalization of communities of color would happen if HQ2 got their headquarters in Queens. However, Amazon is the only, it's the biggest private corporation in the world with the most access to government data. So they have the most authorizations for collecting data on immigrant communities, all communities. But they have the most agency in being able to store information and build profiles on immigrants in our city and share that information with ICE. Not only that, Amazon is the entire backbone of Trump's deportation machine. They host cloud computing technology for DHS, CBP, ICE, and Palantir, which is the corporation that provides the tracking technology to ICE and CBP agents. So they are the entire infrastructure of Trump's deportation machine, and we don't need that in our city. However, Amazon has a presence in New York City and state, has a presence around the world. So in partnership with Jews for Racial and Economic Justice, Mi Gente, Empower, ACRE, New York Communities for Change, and dozens of other organizations, we launched the No Tech for ICE campaign locally. Mi Gente really spearheaded the research and advocacy, and here at Make the Road, we began organizing massive mobilizations around No Tech for ICE, and we've had very exciting actions so far. So the No Tech for ICE campaign has to be multifaceted. The No Tech for ICE campaign will involve politicizing thousands of immigrant and communities of colors, members of immigrant and communities of colors, to understand the impact of Amazon's monopoly power in our society, in our economy, in our democracy, and in our daily lives, right? So first it starts with educating the masses. It starts like this, one-on-one, educating each other on how to protect ourselves from the powers of massive tech companies. So that's where we start. Where we move is then mobilizing the politicized membership into mass direct action. So those are actions, for example, what we did on July 11th outside of the Javits Center. It's disrupting everyday business as usual for these companies so that they know we're watching them. It's putting pressure on the board of investors, on the leadership, on executives, on tech workers on the inside to raise the issues of immigrant communities calling for No Tech for ICE and No Tech for Police, right? So we're gonna be employing a series of direct actions at these corporations, and we've already done a few. We are strategically targeting Amazon because they are the example in the industry for how to dismantle workers' rights, how to separate families, how to harm Black, Brown, immigrant, and Indigenous communities, and are setting a precedent for every other corporation to follow. The warehouse industry is the fastest growing industry in the country while retail is on the decline. Amazon warehouses were named the most dangerous workplace in America last year, and that number's only gotten worse as recent reports come out. This is why we're putting power behind the beast. we are taking on Amazon for all of their issues. On February 18th, on Valentine's Day, they said they chose to leave New York City because they felt attacked from every single angle. And that's exactly what we're going to do. We're going to attack them from every single angle until this corporation is broken up, until Jeff Bezos has to pay his taxes and his net worth is taxed and he does not have the wealth that he has accrued right now, which is just stolen wages from his workforce. I think the immigration movement right now as a whole has put forward protect DACA, protect TPS, abolish ICE, and citizenship for all, right? That is the platform. And the immigration movement is strategically incorporating the component of corporations, private corporations that are benefiting from Trump's orders to escalate the amount of arrests, deportations, and separation of communities in our country. Right, so in order for us to abolish ICE, in order for us to win citizenship for all, we have to, as movement leaders, carefully assess and target the corporations that are profiting from the government's agenda. They are not separate. They are absolutely working together. We stood up to the world's largest corporation, and we got them to reverse their decision after months of organizing, and that's because immigrants said no to a corporation that separates families and provides tech to ICE. We said no to labor abuse. We said no to displacement and to gentrification. We said no to massive giveaways to billionaires. And from there, launched platforms for organizing warehouse workers, for introducing legislation around community-based economic development, housing protections, labor protections. So it's been a very exciting year.
Si estás interesada en inscribirte en las diferentes opciones de educación superior que CUNY ofrece, las cuales varían desde cursos en las universidades comunitarias hasta un doctorado, contacta a nuestras oficinas en el teléfono 1-800-CUNY-YES o visita nuestro sitio de internet www.cuny.edu.
Yo nací aquí en Brooklyn, Nueva York. Entonces, a la edad de 8 años, yo y mi familia nos mudamos todos a México. Entonces, yo crecí en México casi la mayoría de mi vida. Fue algo nuevo, un ambiente totalmente diferente aquí, ya que nos fuimos a mudar a un pueblo bien pequeño, pequeño. Casi ahí todo el mundo se conoce. La escuela, porque entré allá a cuarto año, entonces igual la escuela fue algo definitivamente muy nuevo. Y también el lenguaje, el idioma, no me sabía yo comunicar en español para nada. Mi primer, digamos, baile, que fue en la primaria, tenía yo, creo que yo iba yo en quinto año. Y pues cada año, pues, yo participaba, y si no, hasta ya que iba yo a la secundaria, a los 15 años, cuando dije, eso es algo que me gusta. El primer grupo que fui parte, Yavi Daxiu, estaban en Queens. Entonces yo viajaba de Brooklyn a Queens a los ensayos. Y es cuando encontré una compañía folclórica aquí en Nueva York, el cual me puse en contacto, y sí me tocó ir a audicionar para ellos. Pude experimentar por primera vez, ¿no?, un ambiente profesional. La verdad sí me encantó, y sí fue intimidante, pero igual eso me dio las ganas de seguir yendo a los ensayos. Yo me emocionaba cuando eran los días de ensayo, Y ya estaba yo lista. Yo soy la primera persona de mi familia de graduarme de la universidad. Llegué acá, de hecho, yo creía que me iban a dejar solamente en el último año de high school, pero me regresaron 3 años atrás. Igual fue el mismo obstáculo que tuve cuando me fui a México, el idioma, ya que pues se me había casi borrado el cassette. No tenía el nivel de inglés adecuado para college level, entonces tuve que tomar remedial classes. Cuando estaba yo haciendo mi research en senior colleges, ya que en Kingsborough estaba yo estudiando turismo, encontré que Hunter ofrecía esta carrera, ¿no?, de danza. Entonces sí, decidí cambiarme. Digo, me gusta la danza, like, quiero hacer algo que me gusta, me apasiona y que la verdad pues sí me encanta hacer. Entonces, y sí, cambié de carrera. En la danza a veces no hay mucha representación, y pues yo quería dar esa representación mediante mi cultura, mi historia y nomás mi presencia en sí. Ajá.
Llévame cans de llorar y no
mantener. Dos requerimientos para poder graduarte era hacer un solista.
Como tú tienes la...
Y entonces en esa pieza sí me inspiré mucho en una pintura de Frida Kahlo que se llama The Broken Column.
Palombolera, palombolera,
y hacer y coreografiar una pieza grupal. De hecho lo titulé Tonatiu, que se refiere al dios sol. La razón que mi piel es morena es que el sol me ha dado más besos, so that's why. Basado especialmente en la historia prehispánica, y me inspiró mucho la arquitectura. Y quería yo darle ese sentimiento, ¿no?, que todavía seguimos aquí, que nuestros ancestros aún están presentes, y aunque like espiritualmente, I can feel them. He aprendido sobre la diversidad mediante estas danzas, la diversidad que hay en México, la cultura, la historia de los pueblos. Entonces la danza definitivamente me abrió toda una perspectiva. Ahí estoy con Mixteca, soy coordinadora de educación, y el área de educación pues se enfoca en mayoría en la educación adulta, ofreciendo clases de inglés, alfabetización y también computación y algunos talleres educativos. Entonces Mixteca está ubicado en Sunset Park, en la calle 23. Su misión de Mixteca es poder brindar estos servicios gratuitos en área de educación, salud mental y inmigración a la comunidad inmigrante de habla hispana. Ya la organización lleva ya más de alrededor de 20 años. He esto de la pandemia definitivamente sí tuvimos que moderar todos nuestros servicios, así como esas clases, nuestros servicios a modo virtual. Sí creamos un fondo de emergencia, ya que desafortunadamente muchos de nuestros miembros de la comunidad se quedaron fuera del alivio gubernamental. Y de los víveres se pueden poner en contacto ahorita mediante Facebook, con que nos manden su nombre, dirección y número de teléfono, y ya los encargados o las coordinadoras de los víveres se van a poner en contacto con las personas para ver si hay algún cupo o si es que los ponemos en una lista de espera. Y pues a mí, la verdad, sí me enorgullece ser parte de ese equipo, ya que gracias a Mixteca pude conectarme cerca con la comunidad. Pude igual, me ayudó a adquirir nuevas habilidades en cuestión de profesionalismo, ser parte de un equipo que es joven, la mayoría son mujeres inmigrantes o que vienen parte de una familia inmigrante. Entonces definitivamente refleja la comunidad que servimos. También, si hay posibilidad de que puedan donar, también pueden donar a nuestros fondos. Lo pueden buscar en nuestra página web, que es mixteca.org. Tenemos un GoFundMe. Entonces ahí pueden donar lo que ustedes desean. Pueden igual ponerse en contacto con nosotros mediante Facebook, o si no, igual nos pueden mandar un correo electrónico a info@mixteca.org.
Thank you. In a country that professes to be the land of the free, one that more than any other in the history of society is made up of such a diverse background of races, cultures, and traditions, it sadly seems that these days we are regressing further and further into divisions of class, race, and political ideals. As a millennial, I feel that a generation was somewhat fortunate to have grown up in a time of relative peace and a seemingly upward trajectory in terms of socioeconomic and political ideas as a collective society. My high school and early adult years coincided with our first Black president, progressive reforms, and a general sense of increasing acceptance amongst our people, regardless of who we were, where we came from, and what we identified as. How wrong I was. Underneath this facade of progression was a burgeoning pot of hate and nationalism that needed just the slimmest hint of validation to show its ugly face. In the last year, this toxic soup not only burst through the seams, but somehow managed to manifest itself into a White House administration. So incredulous, even the most cynical dystopian authors cannot possibly conceive. Without getting into too much detail about their callous acts that threaten the safety of our nation, I will focus on one that hits a bit closer to home. From the moment 45 derided our Mexican brothers as bad hombres, until at last the orange one pulled the rug underneath 800,000 Americans on September 5th. The announcement of the rescission of DACA, or the Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals. A national program initiated by the Obama administration in 2012 that provided immigrants who arrived on American soil at a young age with the opportunity to work, have a social security number, and finally feel like they belonged here. It was not a perfect program by any means. DACA recipients pay taxes just as any American would, but were ineligible for any federal or state aid, including Medicare, student grants, etc. What it did do, though, was give hardworking Americans, by anything other than a simple 9-digit number, a chance to finally achieve their dreams.